The BBC's biggest stars are now 20-year-old and their concerned parents, playing out in the tabloid press and often live on air.
These are clearly damaging to the BBC. It's not a good situation.
Today, the BBC's Director General, a man originally sent in to steady the ship, entered yet another storm. Giving his only interview to the BBC, Tim Davey conceded the whole affair was damaging.
What I've said is you always have lessons that you learn from these situations. And we're doing two things, Sarah. Firstly, I think there's a valid question that I'm asking, which is, how are complaints like this red flagged through the organisation?
Right.
And I want that immediately looked at, and also review the overall process and protocols to make sure we're satisfied by them.
This afternoon, pressure on the presenter intensified as a second person came forward in their early 20s, claiming to the BBC that they felt threatened by the star. After chatting on a dating app, they were under pressure, they say, to meet up, but never did. The young adult then suggested they might reveal the identity of the star online. The presenter sent them expletive-filled messages. Last week, the Sun newspaper claimed the same star had paid a young person for sexually explicit photos. Today, the BBC released new details on what it knew and when. On May the 18th, a family member attended a BBC building where they tried to make a complaint about the behaviour of a presenter. On May the 19th, the BBC's corporate investigations team found the allegations were serious, but there was no mention of criminality. They made attempts to email the family, but got no response. On June the 6th, having received no response to the email, a phone call was made, but this did not connect, and no more attempts were made to contact the family until a month later. On July the 6th, the Sun newspaper informs the BBC of allegations concerning one of their stars. This was the first time the Director General or the presenter were told of the complaint. So where does this all leave us today, you may ask? Well, what is clear is that once the Sun had contacted the BBC last week, action was swift. Only then was the Director General informed, the presenter was spoken to, later suspended. The police became involved. What is less clear, however, and there are now serious questions about that initial investigation back in May. Was it diligent? We know that the family were now contacted twice, once via email, a phone call. Was that enough? Even the Prime Minister, who had flown all the way to Lithuania for a NATO summit, could not escape the crisis.
Obviously, they're very serious and concerning allegations, and that's why I'm pleased that the Culture Secretary spoke to the Director General of the BBC over the weekend and is confident that the BBC is investigating this both rigorously and rapidly. I think that's the right course of action.
Today, the Metropolitan Police confirmed they'd asked the BBC to pause its own investigation while they try to establish whether a crime had been committed. And tonight, we can reveal a second police force has told this programme they were contacted back in April regarding the welfare of an adult. At the time, no criminality was identified, but now further inquiries are ongoing. As a lawyer for the 20-year-old, called claims that anything unlawful had happened rubbish, saying a denial via WhatsApp was sent on Friday, but the newspaper published the story anyway. We asked the Sun whether they had received the message, who told us they would not be commenting on specifics. And that has become a theme across the board, a scandal with many questions left unanswered.
Minnie Stevenson reporting. Well, earlier I spoke to the former editor of The Guardian newspaper, Alan Rusbridger, and began by asking him what he thought of the BBC's response and a warning there is mildly offensive language in this interview.
It's a very difficult situation to handle. And the whole case is very unusual because it began essentially with a newspaper doing the opposite of what newspapers normally do. Normally a newspaper says, we name the guilty man. And here you had a newspaper saying, we don't name the guilty man, but would you mind naming him for us? That suggests to me that the Sun has had legal advice saying that they would be unwise to name him, which is probably exactly the same legal advice that the BBC is dealing with.
And yet, if you look at who seems to be, which organisation seems to be under the most pressure, it's most certainly the BBC. They seem to be coming under huge pressure to out their own presenter, while the Sun isn't really talked about at the moment. What do you make of that?
Well, I think there's not much sympathy for the BBC in much of the British press for understandable reasons. Certainly isn't from Rupert Murdoch. And it's a national hobby of beating up the BBC, and the BBC people are used to that. But we're operating in circumstances where we know we don't know more than we do know. We know a little more today, thanks to Tim Davie. We know about the timeline. We can't really be sure what the BBC was told 7 weeks ago. And so, therefore, it's difficult to judge whether their actions were sufficient or fast enough or had enough of a red flag attached to them.
And, of course, the question many people will still be asking is, how long can it go on that this BBC presenter remains anonymous, remains unnamed? What do you think?
Well, it's a really difficult balance. The person at the heart of it deserves due process and deserves for their case to be handled with due care and process. The point that I made about the Sun hasn't named him, because they obviously feel they're slightly lacking the killer punch to do so. So you have to follow due process. At the same time, you've got this great clamour, you've got a police investigation, you've got the potential of other people coming out, and you've got a lot of BBC staff who are really pissed off because for as long as he's not named, they feel that they might be in the frame. So it's a miserable situation for everybody. And the sooner the police can come out and free the BBC to take the action they need to, the better.
But if, for example, it turns out that there is no criminal behaviour identified, do you think it's still possible that this person will have to be named or will have to name themselves?
Well, then I think it becomes a matter of whether this person has behaved in a matter that brings the corporation into disrepute. Then, as in with any organisation, they could well be removed, sacked,